Welcome. This is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is Exploration. Every week on Exploration, we summarize some of the top news in science and technology, and once again, we're going to summarize the latest in terms of what is known and not known about the coronavirus. We'll talk about Operation Warp Speed. Is it possible that a crash program and billions of dollars can jumpstart our search for the Holy Grail, and that is a vaccine against the coronavirus? And then we'll talk about some mysteries that are gradually being solved about the coronavirus. First of all, why do we have super spreaders? That is, a single individual that can spread the virus to up to 100 other people. The scientific question is, how far can your water droplets spread once you cough or even talk to a person in a closed environment? And then also the big question, why are some people so susceptible to the virus and other people just shrug it off? I mean, there are thousands of people that are non-symptomatic that'll never come down with symptoms consistent with the coronavirus, but they can spread the virus to other people. So why is it that some people are sent to the ventilators and the ICUs and other people don't feel a thing? And then what happens if we don't get a vaccine at all? Then we're going to have to rely on therapeutics. Because after all, even today, there's no vaccine against HIV, no vaccine against the common cold, no vaccine against cancer. We more or less live with them, and we have therapeutics. And so we'll talk about therapeutics, and then we'll talk about, will there be a second wave? Given the fact that many states are now beginning to unlock their citizenry, and the question is, what happens if we have a second, third, or fourth wave of infections? And let me also repeat once again that I do not have a PhD in biochemistry. So if you're beginning to show symptoms of the coronavirus, such as a fever, a dry cough, and chest pains, then of course call your local physician. However, I do have a PhD in theoretical physics. And out of theoretical physics came computer modeling. We practically invented it. And of course, computer modeling is one of the key ways that we use, a tool that we use to predict the course of this horrible virus. Well, let's just jump right into some of the top news concerning the coronavirus. One persistent question has been, why do we have super spreaders? That is, one individual who goes to nightclubs in South Korea, five nightclubs, infects perhaps 100 individuals. Or one lady going to a bridge club infects most of the members of that bridge club. Or a person who sings in a church choir infects almost the entire church choir. Why is that? Well, remember just a few months ago, the government said that you don't have to wear a mask. Masks are for people who are on the front line, and therefore you don't want to take away from them, so masks are not necessary. Now, of course, people jump on any elected official who does not wear a mask. So how effective is the mask anyway? And also, the government guidelines say you should stay 6 feet away from other people to prevent infecting them. Well, now new studies done by scientists around the world are casting doubt on this, and we now realize that the virus is probably much more contagious than we previously thought. First of all, using lasers to eliminate water droplets in the air after just ordinary speech or just singing or talking loud, you can show that there are about 1,000 water droplets that come out of your mouth per minute, and they can linger in the air for 8 minutes to 14 minutes. This is a dramatic reversal of what previously what people thought, that these water droplets would simply fall to the ground and go no further than 6 feet. In fact, there was one lady at a bridge game who infected most of her bridge club. Scientists have been able to track the location of every single person in that bridge club, where they were sitting when she played bridge. And we now realize that she was infecting people out to 15 feet in an enclosed environment. Also, we have these super spreaders going through church choirs because people are singing in a church choir. They're in close quarters, and it is singing and loud voices that spread the most water droplets, up to 100,000 per minute. So I repeat, even though these droplets may be totally invisible, even though the conversation you have may be totally innocent, somebody who sings loud or speaks loud can hurl up to 100,000 droplets per minute. And these droplets, in turn, can stay in the air for 8 to 14 minutes. And so we're beginning to realize that this 6 feet rule, well, we should maintain it, but it's not enough. In fact, many scientists are beginning to say that we should at some point tell people to watch out for the following, and that is, do not stay in an enclosed environment, especially in the presence of people who speak loud or are singing. Go outside or stay away from these individuals, because you could be bombarded by literally thousands of water droplets that can sail not just 6 feet, but perhaps up to 20 feet. So, in other words, don't talk to people, especially loud individuals, people who are singing in an enclosed environment. Stay away from parties where you have loud noises and people are shouting and having a great time. And if possible, stay away from restaurants and barbershops where people are in close vicinity with other people, and especially airplanes, especially if the air in the airplane is not circulated. And so we're now beginning to realize that these super spreaders are much more common than we previously thought, and that masks, which were once considered optional, actually are rather a first line of defense against some of these water droplets. And remember that most of the water droplets do fall within 6 feet, but aerosols, droplets that could be as tiny as a red blood cell, aerosols like perfume can spread much farther than just 6 feet. So a word to the wise, avoid people who are loud, singing, avoid long conversations, avoid being in an enclosed surrounding like in a home, in an airplane, a restaurant where the air does not circulate, or an elevator. And again, these are guidelines that are informal. They're not official. But a word to the wise, this could explain why we have super spreaders that can infect up to 100 other people. And then we have another persistent riddle, perhaps the biggest riddle of all, and that is, why are some people more susceptible to the coronavirus? Why is it that some people can simply walk away, be totally asymptomatic, and yet up to 50% of these asymptomatic people could be infecting everyone around them? Why is that? Well, there's some clues and some theories now being proposed. First of all, your blood type. It turns out that statistically speaking, if you are blood type A, you are more susceptible to the virus and its after effects than if you have blood type O. Also, men are more vulnerable than women. Also, people who have hypertension and underlying factors like that are more susceptible. So what is the common link between blood type, men, and people with hypertension? Well, there is a theory. First of all, how does the coronavirus invade your body? It's just a molecule, after all. It's not even alive. First of all, there are spike proteins, the spikes along the surface of the virus. That's where the virus latches on to your cells. But where on your cells is there a docking site? Is there a site where the spike protein can latch onto? In your cells, especially your lung cells, you have what is called the ACE2 docking site. The ACE2 docking site is where the spike proteins latch onto your cell. Then there's another gene which acts like a can opener, which basically opens the cell wall, allowing the virus to inject its DNA into your cell to make copies of itself, which will then go on to make more copies of itself. And after a while, you begin to have chest pains and maybe go to the hospital. So it turns out that the ACE receptor could be the weak link. It could be the common factor that links blood type A, men, and people with hypertension. And so this is still a theory. It has to be, of course, tested and verified. But it does seem as if people with more ACE2 receptors, like men, for example, are more susceptible to the virus than people who don't. Now, this means that in the future, we may be able to target the ACE2 receptor to make sure that they can withstand the assault from the spike protein. Perhaps that is a weak spot which we can use to make sure that the virus does not penetrate into our lungs. And then the next question is, well, what can we do about it? Well, the president has announced Operation Warp Speed, and that is a crash program the likes of which we haven't seen since the Manhattan Project, Operation Warp Speed, to give us a vaccine for the coronavirus by the end of this year. Is that possible? Already some of the critics are saying that a vaccine will take longer than we thought, but is it possible to take shortcuts? First of all, there are thousands of people who are healthy who have volunteered to be infected, deliberately infected by the virus, if it will help speed up the creation of a vaccine. That alone could shave off months in the time frame, because most people's time frame do not include the fact that some people by the thousands will volunteer to be infected by a virus that kills you perhaps 1 to 2% of the time. So these are heroes. These people are volunteering for the sake of the human race, for the sake of civilization. They are volunteering to be infected by the virus. So is Operation Warp Speed possible? Well, yes, it can't be ruled out. In fact, the group at Oxford even has a head start. At Oxford University, they have already done for the SARS virus and other viruses the groundwork necessary to create their version of a vaccine. So around the world in different countries, there are about 5 serious trials about to go to human trials, about to be tested on humans. Already in Oxford, their version of the virus has already been successfully tested on monkeys. These monkeys were deliberately infected by the virus, and they didn't come down. So it means that there's hope. But we have to be cautious. Just because it works in monkeys, it does not yet mean it'll work in humans. But the fact that thousands of people are volunteering to be infected by the virus, I think, could speed up Operation Warp Speed. However, we do have to entertain the possibility that maybe we won't find any vaccine at all. Now, again, the betting is that with a crash program, with so many thousands of people volunteering to be tested, it's conceivable that we could have a vaccine by the end of this year or perhaps the beginning of next year. But what happens if there's no vaccine at all? For example, take a look at HIV. There's no vaccine against HIV. Look at the common cold, the rhinovirus. There's no vaccine against the common cold. Look at cancer, the second largest killer in the United States. There's no vaccine against cancer. So what went wrong? Well, first of all, if you have a vaccine against a certain virus, you want to make sure the virus doesn't mutate too rapidly. For example, take a look at influenza. The influenza flu virus does mutate, and that's why every year there's a new vaccine, because it's a moving target. Fortunately, it does not mutate that much, so a shot once a year is enough to bring the influenza virus under control. But HIV is different. HIV mutates at a very rapid rate, so fast that it's simply useless to commercially produce a vaccine against one version of HIV when another version is just coming down the pike. In fact, if you are infected by HIV, it is quite different from the virus that will actually kill you, because it has mutated in that period of time. That's how fast the HIV virus can mutate. It's a moving target, moves and mutates so fast that a vaccine against the HIV is very difficult to create. Now take a look at the common cold, the rhinovirus. There are over 300 different versions of the rhinovirus, and it is simply not commercially viable to do research on 300 different types of viruses. And take a look at cancer. Cancer is not really one disease at all. Cancer is caused by broken genes, genes that can be mutated using chemicals, radiation. There's a number of ways in which cancers can be formed because of mutations in our genome. So in other words, it's a moving target, with every single type of tissue being one of the targets that can create hundreds of different kinds of broken genes. And that's the reason why we don't have a cancer vaccine. And also, you have to worry about side effects. There was a scandal years ago with thalidomide. Thalidomide was being touted as this miracle sleeping pill, but it had a disastrous side effect which was not known. It caused horrible, horrible birth defects. Children born without arms or legs. It was a tragedy. A whole generation of young kids born that were deformed because no one had done the human trials on thalidomide to look at its side effects. Therefore, we all hope that something like Operation Warp Speed will work, but if it doesn't work, what's the backup plan? Well, the backup plan is therapeutics. For example, take a look at HIV. There's no vaccine against HIV, as I mentioned, but we have therapeutics because we know the life history, the life cycle of the HIV virus. And there are at least three weak spots, three choke points, three places in the reproduction cycle of the virus where it is vulnerable. Therefore, you can create a cocktail of drugs that specifically target these three weak spots in the life cycle of the HIV. And so it's not a cure, but we live with it. And therefore, the question is, can we do something like that with the coronavirus? Well, first of all, there's been a lot of news about remdesivir. Remdesivir is an antiviral that was used against Ebola rather unsuccessfully. However, it does seem to have some reproducible therapeutic effect against the coronavirus. It's not a cure, but it can reduce the time that you were infected from 15 days down to 11 days. Now, that may not sound much, but just realize that the longer you are on a ventilator, the more chances that you will die. In fact, the probability of dying once you are on the ventilator approaches 90%. So once they hook you up to the ventilator, that could be the kiss of death. But, well, hey, what else can we do? There's nothing else. Well, that's why therapeutics come in. Therapeutics work mainly by trial and error, by making lots of mistakes, by trying all sorts of dead ends. But remdesivir, perfected against the Ebola virus unsuccessfully, may be used against the coronavirus. And then there's convalescent antibody therapy, where you take the blood of people that have been infected and survived, take the plasma from their blood, which is full of antibodies, then inject that into the blood of somebody that is on the ICU because of the coronavirus. So you're using somebody else's antibodies to defend a patient's blood against the virus. Well, that is something that's been tried 100 years ago. In fact, against the 1918 Spanish flu virus, it works. It's not a cure, but it does work. That's another possibility. However, there's another possibility that is a spin-off of that version. You see, once you are infected by the coronavirus, then it turns out that you can take your plasma, refine it, and use it to help maybe three other individuals. But wouldn't it be better if you could somehow take these antibodies, clone them, artificially clone them to make literally millions of copies of the antibodies against the coronavirus for scores of other patients? That's being looked at as well. So once again, convalescent antibody therapy does work. It takes the antibodies from another individual, injects it into somebody who is suffering from the coronavirus. But why not? Why not enhance? Enhance the antibodies using genetic engineering. That is a distinct possibility. And then there are also some wild cards that are being looked at. One of them is vitamin D. That's right. There's no proof that vitamin D can cure the virus. However, statistically speaking, if you take a look at the incidence of the virus and its severity in Italy and Spain, you realize those countries have a relatively low level of vitamin D in their blood. Countries which have a higher level of vitamin D in their blood seem to do better against the virus. Now, this is not the aha moment at all. Of course, it could be a coincidence, but it's still something to look at. And then news out of Hong Kong. This three-drug cocktail idea that was used against HIV, why not use it against the coronavirus? And they've had some reproducible success. That's right. By looking at the weak spots in the reproduction cycle of the coronavirus, you can show that there are at least three choke points, three areas where if you use certain chemicals, you can interfere with the reproduction cycle of the coronavirus. And again, this is not a cure. It's a therapeutic, but it's something to look at. Because that's the philosophy that we use against HIV. There's no vaccine against HIV. We simply live with it, and it's tolerable. In addition, there's also another dark horse candidate, a therapeutic against the coronavirus, and that is BCG. Now, BCG is commonly used in Asia, where people are inoculated against tuberculosis. Now, BCG is not widely used in the United States, where tuberculosis is not such a problem. But it turns out that BCG not only helps to protect you against tuberculosis, but another set of different kinds of unrelated diseases at all. And it's not quite known why is it that sometimes an antiviral drug against one virus is actually good against several others. And realize that tuberculosis is spread not by a virus at all, but by a bacterium. However, there is a theory that says that because, for example, most Japanese people have been inoculated against tuberculosis with BCG, it must mean that their rate of coronavirus infection should also be lower than usual as a consequence. Well, if you've been reading the headlines, you know that the number one factor driving this whole coronavirus pandemic is the question of when to end lockdown. State after state are now enacting some kind of procedures and guidelines to open up their beaches, restaurants, barbershops, and what have you. And of course, epidemiologists are cringing. If they had their way, they would simply lock up everybody for an indefinite period of time until the coronavirus infection rate goes to zero. Well, that's not going to happen. It's a trade-off. And so the question is, what price is society willing to pay to control the coronavirus and yet not totally demolish the economy as well? We have several good examples of countries that have a handle on the virus. Taiwan and South Korea stand out, for example, because they started early. And to be honest, they had a head start because of the SARS virus. They knew how dangerous this virus could be because they saw firsthand the chaos that was created by the SARS virus, another coronavirus, by the way. And so they were prepared. Their people were prepared. They were willing to make the sacrifices. In fact, South Korea has curtailed many civil liberties, which would be intolerable in the United States. For example, cell phone records are used to track super spreaders and to track the progress of contact tracing. That kind of invasion of privacy may not be allowed in the United States. But even here, people are beginning to say that, well, there's a trade-off. At some point, we may have to rethink privacy, given the fact that we have to look at the benefit of society as a whole. Now, there is some lessons to be learned from the 1918 pandemic, and that is that they too had a first wave, a very horrible first wave, and it passed, and then lockdowns ended. People began to play, do whatever they do in a normal day, and there was a second wave. The second wave was even worse than the first wave. And so there's a lesson here. And the lesson here is that society has to be willing to pay a price. What is that price? How much are we willing to pay, given the fact that zero infection rate is simply not politically possible? That's a question that every state and every country is now grappling with. Well, that concludes the first part of Exploration and all the latest news concerning the coronavirus. And now we're going to leave inner space and go into outer space with our favorite astronomer, Dr. Neil Tyson, host of the Cosmos series on TV. So stay tuned now as we launch ourselves out of the Earth into orbit around the universe. Welcome. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is the second half of Exploration. Let's now leave the world of viruses and pandemics and plagues and realize that there's a whole universe outside the Earth. Yes, there's a whole universe out there. And who best to guide us through the intricacies of the universe than Dr. Neil deGrasse Tyson, Director of the Hayden Planetarium and also host of the Cosmos series on TV. So once again, today we're going to leave the world of viruses and pandemics and enter the world of the universe with Dr. Neil deGrasse Tyson.
The first question for you, Dr. Tyson, is if you're a beginner and you want to look at the night sky via a telescope, but you don't want to buy a toy, but on the other hand, you don't want to spend thousands of dollars on the top-of-the-line telescope, what kind of telescope would you advise a beginner to get?
You know, I get that question maybe a billion times a month.
Okay, well, billion and one now.
You're right. You don't want to get a toy because the toys, the cheap telescopes, no matter what they tell you on the box, the problem with the cheap telescopes is they're not only hard to use because they have bad mountings and you aim it at something and you just breathe on the telescope and the mounting shifts where the telescope was looking at and the image quality is poor. So just remove that from consideration. If you're worried about spending more on a telescope, then don't get the telescope at all. Just get a good pair of binoculars.
Mm-hmm.
And you can get a good pair for anywhere between $30 and $50. And binoculars are great because particularly if you're a kid, you can do more than just look up with them. You can look horizontally with them.
Right.
And if you go to sporting events and that sort of thing. So binoculars have a tremendous utility that a telescope wouldn't have if you were never going to go beyond the entry level. So beyond that now, I would recommend a telescope. You'd have to spend, I think, at least $100.
Mm-hmm.
But consider that the telescope doesn't go out of style, and you'll have it for your entire life. So for things that you have for your entire life, $100 actually looks pretty cheap. And some better ones are up around $200 or $300. But what you want to make sure is that you have a sturdy enough mounting to keep a stable image in view. And telescopes get more and more and more expensive depending on how many bells and whistles you add.
Mm-hmm.
You get up around $1,000, telescopes have computer-controlled pointing systems. Back in my day, we had to actually know where things were in the night sky.
Now you can be a dummy and simply
just type it in, you know, and the telescope, it has GPS controllers so that knows where it is on Earth and knows where to point. So
you do nothing. You just sit it on the floor and it sort of like finds itself, right?
It makes coffee for you.
Yeah.
I would say there are a lot of camera shops that not only will be happy to sell you a piece of junk, your average good camera shop will also have the slightly higher level telescopes to sell you. And you want to make sure you have at least a couple of lenses, one to see large objects like the moon, others to see smaller ones where you need higher magnification. But so basically it's quite broad, and you might have specific needs. For example, maybe you don't have a car and you have to carry the thing yourself. Well, you know, you stay away from the heavier telescopes. There's some simple needs that you might need have to accommodate simply based on where you're going to take the thing. But I can tell you this, if you happen to have a couple of dollars and you want to get a big, powerful telescope, the drawback is it may be so big that it's hard to take with you to places that you might otherwise be going, and then you don't end up using it at all.
Mm-hmm.
So try to find the telescope that's big enough, and telescope bigger is generally better. It's one of the few things in life where it's always true. Okay, bigger telescopes.
We won't mention the other parts of life where it's not
generally true. Are always better than little telescopes because they collect more light.
Mm-hmm.
If you collect more light, you can see dimmer things in the universe.
Mm-hmm.
So a simple telescope, a non-toy simple telescope, you can see the rings of Saturn, the moons of Jupiter, the weather bands on Jupiter. You can watch Jupiter rotate. You can see the craters on the moon. You can watch Venus go through phases. You can see that Mars is red and has ice caps on it. With proper filters, you can see sunspots on the sun in the daytime. You can see fuzzy splotches on the night sky, some of which are galaxies outside of the Milky Way. Others are just regions where stars are about to be born. So you can get pretty far on one of these first-level telescopes. But a larger telescope then will bring much more detail to those fuzzy objects, where you need more light to find out what you're looking at. And you'll see spiral structures and galaxies. You'll see centers of star clusters. With more light, you can see dimmer things. And the worst place to be for any of this is the city, Mm-hmm. Make sure you've got friends in the country.
Right. Country
make
house,
sure you know the country mouse, you know?
Right. So buy a telescope and a country house at the same time.
Yeah, there you go.
Now, there are two kinds of telescopes. One is the so-called spyglass or refracting telescope, this long tube. Mm-hmm. And then you also have, of course, the reflecting telescope of Isaac Newton. Mm-hmm. So how big a telescope, which telescope would you recommend? And if you get a reflector, how big a mirror would you recommend?
I would say the largest practical sized, that is, kind you can just sort of pick up and take with you, a reflector, is going to be the 6-inch reflector. And it has a 6-inch diameter mirror at the back end, and light comes in, reflects off the mirror, bounces back to a device where you stick your eyepiece. And 6-inch diameter is a pretty good diameter for all things considered.
Mm-hmm.
And but the reflecting telescopes are, because they're open-ended, dust can get in and you can actually drop things down and scratch the mirror. The other kind, the spyglass-style telescope, which is the more classically proportioned telescope, that if you were to draw a telescope sight unseen, it's mm-hmm. probably the one you would draw, the kind that pirates use. You know, it's just this long tube with a lens at one end and a lens at the other end, and akin to what Galileo developed. That kind of telescope is a refracting telescope. Of course, it describes what the lens does to the light. It refracts, it bends the light down to a focus. And my personal first telescope was a 2.5-inch refractor. And that's it's a nice size telescope, and it can see all these things that I told you a moment ago, the rings of Saturn and craters and mountains and valleys on the moon. But it's a little more rugged. It's rugged. If you've got sort of rugged kids, for example, or if you yourself are a rugged adult, mm-hmm. that's the kind of telescope you would sort of haul with you mm-hmm. as you went out into the country.
And speaking about the rings of Saturn, during the Yankee game several years ago, it's a famous episode where the cameraman zoomed up and showed the rings of Saturn to millions of New Yorkers who had never, ever seen the rings of Saturn.
That is cool. Well, that's a testament to how good the zoom lenses are today.
Yeah.
Lenses, I don't know the age distribution of your audience, but the old-timers will know there was a day before which there were simply no zoom lenses. And if you look at the old TV camera lenses of the past, they had a selection of lenses on a turret, and they would rotate that to bring a different lens into use.
Mm-hmm.
And all of the director's instructions never involved a zoom mm-hmm. because there were no zoom lenses. And the number of optical elements to make a working zoom lens is so high, and the number of surfaces that the light passes through is so high that the true solution to that had to await computers mm-hmm. to make that work. And so now if you can look at a wide-angle view of Yankee Stadium and then zoom into the rings of Saturn, you got a good camera on your hands.
Right.
That would cost much more than your telescope.
Yeah, much more. And the response was so enormous. So many people had never, ever seen the rings of Saturn. They called in. They thought it was a science fiction movie. And it was so great that the next day, they repeated it because the demand was so great during the Yankee game.
Yeah. Well, we need more of that. Just a reminder that sometimes you got to look up.
Mm-hmm. Which is, of course, hard for a lot of people.
Particularly city people, where if you look up, it's a pigeon's there or something, you know. It's, mm-hmm. it's just not a natural thing to
and
do.
And you take your life in your own hands when you look up in the city.
And you might step in something, you know. There's all kinds of hazards in the city.
Okay, now let's talk about your early life. Was a telescope there in your early life that propelled you to become an astrophysicist?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a city kid. In fact, I grew up in New York City, where the night sky, like I said, is a kind of a rare commodity. You don't even know it's there, really, most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And my first telescope, my very first telescope was a Christmas gift from my parents.
Is that right?
And that was this 2.5-inch
How old were you?
Refractor. I was 13.
Mm-hmm.
And
changed your life.
Oh, sorry, it was not for Christmas. It was my birthday, mm-hmm. and I was just turning 13.
Mm-hmm.
And, oh, yeah, changed. Well, no, I already knew where I was going.
Mm-hmm.
But the telescope empowers you mm-hmm. to bring the vision to reality. Because I'd visited the local planetarium in New York, of course, the Hayden Planetarium.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd already been bitten by this cosmic bug. Uh-huh. And now I had this hunger and I had to feed it.
Dr. Tyson, where we last left off, we were talking about your first telescopes. And I understand that they were refracting telescopes, very similar to spyglasses. Could you elaborate on your experiences with early telescopes?
Uh-huh. And so that first telescope was a refracting telescope. And since I kept growing in my hunger and my thirst, I quickly outgrew that. And then I saved money from walking dogs.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, in New York, as you may know,
a lot of demand for walking dogs.
A lot of lazy adults who own dogs in apartment buildings. You can't just let them out the back door. That would be a hazardous exercise if you live on the 30th floor of an apartment building. So you pay somebody, and they take your dogs out, and you walk them. And in my day, you know, I got 50 cents a walk, and a couple of times a day you'd walk the dog. I had it good back then. It doesn't sound like much money, but I didn't have to clean up after the dog the way people do today.
That's the name of the game, right?
Yeah, that's right. That's well, they charge more for it, I think. But anyhow, I used that money to buy my next telescope, which was in fact a 6-inch reflector. And
so now you're with the big boys.
I was card carrying amateur astronomer, and it came with a few lenses. I bought some more lenses. Bought the solar filters, and I was ready. I was ready to take in the universe wherever it would get delivered. And I would haul the telescope to the roof of my apartment building, a 22-story apartment building in the Bronx. And I'm embarrassed to say that I was much older before I realized that the name of the apartment building I grew up in was called the Skyview Apartment.
Was that right?
Because it was just a word with no meaning to me.
Right.
While I lived there, and I looked back and I read the two words Skyview. Yeah, that's what I did up on the roof. So it's fascinating that yes, you can become an astrophysicist even if you are star-starved in the middle of the city.
Mm-hmm. And also, I understand that you have written your memoirs talking about this. Tell us a little bit about your memoirs.
Well, what happened was, I kept getting so many questions about like what I did when I was a kid and what I did in high school and college. I said, let me just write this down. Then I just hand them the book. I said, read this, call me in the morning. My memoir, which in fact had a very first appearance a few years ago, it's now in its new edition that just came out last year, at the end of last year. It's called The Sky Is Not the Limit. And it's subtitled Adventures of an Urban Astrophysicist.
That's a contradiction in terms, right? Like Microsoft Works. That's also a contradiction in terms.
I mean, urban astrophysicist.
Urban astrophysicist.
Well, you got to read it to find out how that contradiction gets resolved. But it's chronicles part of what I think a reader might be interested in, how I got to where I am. But I don't then dwell on that fact because I'm principally an educator, and what I do is I share the universe with people, but through the lens that I happen to carry as an astrophysicist, but also as a sort of public person in that realm. So a lot of them are sort of vignettes on how an astrophysicist sees the world around you.
Okay. Well, now let's talk about big telescopes, really big telescopes, like the Hubble Space Telescope, which is currently orbiting the Earth. But if things go badly for the Hubble Space Telescope, it may plunge like a meteor, like a piece of space junk from outer space, and who knows, may land up in someone's backyard. What do you think about the accomplishments of the Hubble Space Telescope, and do you think it should be allowed to fall back to Earth?
That's a very rich question, and let me address it a couple of ways, but I'm happy to be brief if you have other topics as well you want to cover. The Hubble Telescope, as you may know, just celebrated its 15th anniversary, and there is no telescope that's orbiting the Earth that has that longevity. And that longevity came about, and the belovedness of the telescope in part came about because we were able to fix the thing, to service it, to improve it. As electronics and technologies advanced, you go up and swap out the detector, that's the business end of the telescope, and put in a new one. Because really, a telescope is simply a bucket to collect light. And what you put at the focus end, that's up to whatever is the state of your technologies. So the fact that it was serviceable by the space shuttle, by astronauts, meant that the accomplishments of Hubble could accumulate in our hearts and minds far beyond the normal life expectancy of a space-borne telescope. And so whole generations of people grew up knowing Hubble as their favorite thing, through elementary school, into high school, and into college. So that in part accounts for the love affair we all have with the telescope. Not to mention the striking images that everyone now has as their screensaver for their computer.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at the productivity of the telescope, in scientific terms, as you know, we measure this by not only how many research papers came out of it, but how many citations those research papers received, which is, on the other end, a measure of how influential that research was. And the Hubble telescope, hands down, is the most fertile scientific instrument in the history of science.
Is that right?
That's correct. Mm-hmm. If you combine both of these factors, number of papers published and number of citations received, there is no comparison.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's extraordinary. I mean, yeah. And you wonder, how could anyone say, let's deorbit it? Well, the reason why that came up is there are other telescopes that were on the books,
right,
that were ready to be launched and ready to go up and will go places Hubble does not go, that is, scientifically, will tread ground that Hubble cannot tread.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're left with this fascinating dilemma. There's the bird in the hand, the working telescope that you know is successful and will continue to make discoveries, and this new technology that's going to go up with a new kind of telescope. By the way, the launch vehicle might blow up on the pad, for all we know, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then it's gone.
Right.
You've got nothing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Meanwhile, Hubble's deorbiting. So there are complex sort of funding, scientific, and political issues that surround when you turn off an instrument and when you turn on the next one.
Mm-hmm.
So right now, up to the minute, last I checked, the new head of NASA, who, by the way, has all the right pedigree to get NASA out of its doldrums and take us somewhere interesting.
Mm-hmm.
He's a physicist. He's an engineer. He managed companies. He's got the spirit of a young person. He's got the maturity of an old person. He's got everything. He came from central casting.
I see. Let's hope
who do you need for NASA to take us in? His name is Michael Griffin.
Uh-huh.
But anyhow, right now, he responded to these sort of battle cries of the turning off Hubble, and he says, "Yes, let's look into what it takes to save Hubble, but in a limited budget environment, I have to pull money from other places."
Mm-hmm.
And so he reached to some of these other telescopes,
mm-hmm,
and pulled away the money, not to cancel those missions, but to delay them,
mm-hmm,
which is a softer consequence, right, than actually canceling them. Well, now we have the scientists who are part of those missions complaining, saying, no, this is bad, and so this is the politics of a limited budget.
Mm-hmm. Well, why don't they take a little bit of money from the International Space Station, which nobody wants, and even President George W. Bush has not expressed much enthusiasm for this bathtub in outer space called the International Space Station, and maybe take a little bit of money from the space shuttle. They cost enormous sums of money for
yeah,
the manned space program.
There are two ways I can answer that. One of them is, just since we know we want to go beyond the shuttle and the space station in the new vision for space exploration,
mm-hmm,
why not just turn off the switches now? Just,
mm-hmm,
just abandon them in place or give them to the Europeans, whatever. The problem is there's a lot embedded in that sort of rolling ball. We have international commitments to complete the space station because we have international partners in this exercise. So the recommendations that exist in the new vision for space exploration, now a year and a half old, those recommendations say we will phase out the shuttle, phase out the space station. In big government, you can't just turn off a switch. You have to you need an exit plan. So you turn them out. I mean, you phase them out. And while you phase them out, you phase in the rest of this vision. And so they are now on a phase out trajectory, a phase out plan. To have all the budgets go to zero while we finish the space station. And once the space station's done, the shuttle gets retired.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a good thing, but you just want that to happen even faster.
Yeah, it's a $100 billion space station, and no one can find a mission for it. What's it doing up there?
Well, that's another interesting
history. That's a whole other question.
it was born out of a whole other era. It
mm-hmm.
was conceptually born in the Cold War.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we don't want the commies with space stations over our heads,
right,
you know, kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then you kind of buy into it, and then it's kind of there, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's a complicated political history. I'm
mm-hmm.
happy to say that the new vision for space exploration does not have that depth of politics driving it.
Mm-hmm.
There's exploration driving it. There's economics driving it. The goal and the hope is that it stimulates industries in ways that the stimulation of flight, I mean, the investment in flight stimulated associated industries.
Mm-hmm.
So there's some ambitious plans for it that are, that don't derive from political whim, which I think is can be the strength of any project.
Okay. Now let's talk about the search for life in outer space. The Mars rovers have been roving over the surface.
Let's first talk about the search for intelligent life on Earth.
Oh, okay. Well, there is none. We know that. That's a subtle question.
That's a whole other program, all right? We'll save that one. But go on, I'm sorry.
Okay, well, Mars, right? Mm-hmm. We've had this fascination with Mars and Spielberg. Spielberg and Tom Cruise.
This summer.
Are going to scare the pants off us with, you know, War of the Worlds.
Mm-hmm.
And the question is, well, have we learned anything new? We see pictures of rocks. We see indications of maybe water once floating on the surface of Mars. Anything surprising that caught your attention concerning the Mars rovers?
Well, as you know, the Mars has twin rovers, six wheeling on its surface right now as we speak. One, and they're on opposite sides of the planet, so that there's always one in view that we can talk to and get the data from.
Mm-hmm.
And there's always one in sunlight. So that's a clever way to explore the planet. These two rovers. Now, I am an astrophysicist, not a geologist or a geophysicist. So there's a limit to how excited I can get
mm-hmm.
by just looking at rocks.
A bunch of rocks, right?
Right, right. So, but in all respect to them, I mean, they get into their rocks. You know, mm-hmm. if any of us have known a geologist, their home is filled with rocks
mm-hmm.
that they found out in the valley and in the mountains and in the, you know. So among this, given this fact, the subset of the rocks that I'm curious about are those that could have only formed in the presence of liquid water. Because the goal of the astrophysicist is not tell me what kind of minerals are there, unless those minerals impact or affect the kinds of questions we want to answered about whether Mars once had liquid water.
Because
mm-hmm. on Earth, where there's liquid water, there is life. So we have this, you can call it a bias, but I think it's an okay bias, that the search for life as we know it involves the search for liquid water. So NASA has this mantra, follow the water. And so these rovers had, as one of their primary missions, look for rocks that may have been formed in the presence of water. And in fact, they found them. So we're jumping for joy at this. And so that helps us shape the next mission to Mars, because we know there's no water on Mars on the Martian surface. Where did the water go? It's a big mystery. And most experts in this effort believe the water sunk down into the surface and has now formed a kind of permafrost. And so your next round of missions to Mars are going to have to be able to dig.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're going to go to places where we think the water is shallowest and start digging. And so that's where that's the role of these missions in the big picture for our search for life on Mars.
Mm-hmm. And speaking about digging, in the near future, NASA wants to send a space probe to one of the moons of Jupiter, Europa, which may have a liquid ocean underneath the ice cover. And, no, NASA does have plans. I've seen some of the animation for it. To dig right through the ice of this moon of Jupiter to access the ocean and perhaps one day send a submarine down there. What are your thoughts? Is that a long shot concerning a liquid ocean under the surface of the ice cover of a moon of Jupiter?
That's currently my favorite plan in the works right now.
Mm-hmm.
It's still just sort of being sketched. There's no sort of hardware being committed to that idea yet. But in the minds of creative people, the hardware is getting committed. They're trying to figure out how to do this. There's this moon of Jupiter. By the way, the whole Jupiter system, and it's got dozens of moons. I have lost count. One of those moons is one of the largest among them, discovered by Galileo. In fact, it's called the one of the Galilean moons. It's called Europa. And it is way outside of this zone around the sun where the temperature's just right for liquid water. So for the longest time, no one imagined looking outside of that zone. Earth is in that zone. We're not too close. We're not too far. We're just right. It's Goldilocks. We're just right to have liquid water. You go to Jupiter, you expect everything to be frozen. But you know something? The ice on the European surface is, yes, it's frozen, but you look from one time to the next, there are cracks in the ice. that appear and then refreeze and then appear again. And if you take images of that, it looks just like what goes on in Earth's North Pole.
Mm-hmm.
As you know, there's no land on the North Pole. There's just ice sheets. And so there's strong evidence that the surface of Europa is just an ice sheet floating on top of an ocean that has been liquid for billions of years. If you had a liquid ocean for billions of years, any place you've got liquid water, once again, on Earth, you've got life. Maybe you've got aquatic life on mm-hmm. Europa. So I want to go ice fishing on Europa. Yeah, I want to go to Europa, cut a hole in the ice, put a submersible down, and see what it can see.
Mm-hmm. And God knows what you're going to catch down mm-hmm. there.
Get some dolphin licking the lens or something. That'd be kind of fun.
Uh-huh. Now, does this mean now in outer space, perhaps we were barking up the wrong tree, looking only for Earth-like planets in Goldilocks zones? If tidal forces, the force of gravity tugging on, squeezing Europa, is responsible for heating up the ice cover and melting it, creating an ocean, this could be quite common throughout the universe, right? There could be many icy moons out there heated up by tidal forces and many liquid oceans out there that we never suspected, right?
You're absolutely right. And in fact, thanks for clarifying that. I didn't give the reason why Europa has a liquid ocean. And it is principally because of this gravity war that goes on between Jupiter and Europa and Europa and the other moons. And it's this sort of stress to the planet. The way you stress a racquetball when you hit it and the ball warms up, the same thing happens to Europa. And, well, if Europa can stay warm for reasons that have nothing to do with the sun, then, and if it has life, then who needs the sun?
Mm-hmm.
Not only that, even if it weren't this latter-day cause for pumping energy, we know that Earth has an energy source. There are places at the bottom of the ocean where, as they say, the sun don't shine, and the heat, where there's life that thrives.
Mm-hmm.
Any biology textbook you and I read in school said all of life on Earth requires the sun. Life at the bottom of the ocean has no such prerequisite because it's thriving off of geochemical and geothermal energy sources that are contained within the Earth.
Well, I'm afraid that's it for Exploration. Once again, our special guest in the second half of the show has been Dr. Neil deGrasse Tyson, director of the Hayden Planetarium, and this is Dr. Michio Kaku for Exploration. And if you want a copy of today's show, call the Pacifica Program Service at 1-800-735-0230 for a copy of today's program. Good day.